Few things stir the senses quite like a loaf of perfectly baked bread. From its irresistible aroma, a scent evoking warmth and comfort, to the satisfying crackle of the crust, its golden hue and rustic texture, every detail builds anticipation for that first glorious bite. Yet a closer look at a slice reveals a surprising truth. Bread is predominantly air. In fact, a baked loaf typically consists of 75 to 85% gas by volume, depending on the bread variety. So our bread is essentially full of bubbles. Hey, Seraphin here, and welcome back to the channel. Today we're diving deep into something you might not think much about, but it's absolutely crucial to the bread we love. Bubbles. That beautiful, open, airy structure of a slice of bread, the light texture, and the perfect volume, they all come down to how tiny pockets of gas form and behave throughout the entire bread-making process. It's not just mixing and hoping for the best, it's a fascinating journey guided by physics, chemistry, and biology. Today, we're going to explore the life cycle of a bread bubble, from its chaotic birth during mixing to the final set form in the baked loaf. We'll look at the science behind how bubbles grow, shrink, merge, and stabilize, and how manipulating these processes can dramatically change your final loaf. Let's start at the very beginning, mixing. Think of mixing as the Big Bang for bread bubbles. When you combine flour and water and start mixing or kneading, you're doing three main things. You're homogenizing the ingredients, you're developing the gluten network, and critically for our topic today, you are incorporating air. This air, trapped within the dough matrix, provides the nucleation sites for most of the gas bubbles that will expand later. It's estimated that immediately after mixing, air volume can range from 4 to 15% of the dough volume, or even up to 20% in specific cases. The mechanical energy input during mixing is key here. The intense agitation causes air to get trapped in the liquid phase of the dough. And the way you mix has a huge impact on these initial bubbles. Higher mixing speeds and increased work input tend to incorporate more air and lead to a larger number of bubbles, and can even facilitate the breakup of existing bubbles, resulting in a finer bubble structure. The viscosity of the dough also plays a role. Higher viscosity doughs often require more energy, but can result in smaller bubbles for the same mixing speed. This initial distribution of bubble sizes and numbers is absolutely crucial. It sets the stage for everything that follows. Now, once mixing is complete, the dough moves into its next critical phase, fermentation. This is where the bubbles really start to grow. During alcoholic fermentation, yeast, typically Saccharomyces cerevisiae, utilizes simple sugars present in the wheat flour as a food source. As these simple sugars are depleted, enzymes in the flour and produced by the yeast break down more complex carbohydrates, such as starch, into fermentable sugar. The yeast then metabolizes these sugars in the absence of oxygen, producing ethanol and carbon dioxide as byproducts. The carbon dioxide dissolves into the liquid phase of the dough. And this dissolved carbon dioxide then diffuses into those tiny air pockets that were incorporated during mixing, the nucleation sites we mentioned earlier. This diffusion is the primary driver of bubble expansion during bulk fermentation and proofing. At about the same time, some of this dissolved carbon dioxide also gathers at microscopic irregularities within the dough, such as starch granules or impurities, or the surfaces of the mixing bowl, leading to the formation of more tiny bubbles that also serve as nucleation sites for bubble expansion. This latter process is analogous to how bubbles form on nucleation sites in a glass of beer or soda. Initially, the concentration of carbon dioxide in the liquid phase is low, so the rate of transfer into the bubbles is slow. As the yeast continues to produce carbon dioxide, the concentration in the liquid phase increases, leading to a faster rate of transfer and bubble growth. While achieving carbon dioxide saturation in the liquid phase isn't strictly necessary for growth, bubble growth occurs more readily as the concentration increases. Now, several factors influence the rate of bubble growth during fermentation. Increasing the yeast level increases the rate of carbon dioxide production, accelerating bubble growth and the overall dough expansion. Increasing the temperature also increases the rate of bubble growth. This is partly due to the increased rate of gas production by the yeast at higher temperatures, but also because the solubility of carbon dioxide in the liquid dough phase decreases as temperature increases, encouraging it to move into the gas phase within the bubbles. The initial size and number of bubbles created during mixing also play a role. A greater number of bubbles means a larger total surface area for mass transfer, which can initially lead to a more rapid transfer of gas into the bubbles. However, this can also mean a slower increase in carbon dioxide concentration in the liquid phase, potentially slowing the growth rate later in bulk fermentation and proofing. But bubble growth isn't the only thing happening during fermentation. The bubble population is constantly changing shape and size distribution due to complex physical phenomena. Let's look at some of the key dynamics. First, we have disproportionation, often referred to as Ostwald's ripening. This is driven by the fact that gas pressure inside smaller bubbles is higher than inside larger bubbles due to surface tension effects. This pressure difference causes carbon dioxide to diffuse out of smaller bubbles, dissolve back into the dough matrix, and then diffuse into larger bubbles where the pressure is lower. The result? Smaller bubbles shrink and can disappear, while larger bubbles grow at their expense. This process makes the bubble size distribution wider over time. At the start of bulk fermentation, you might have a relatively narrow distribution of small bubbles. But as fermentation progresses, the distribution spreads out, with many larger bubbles appearing. Disproportionation starts right after mixing and continues into the early stages of bulk fermentation. Factors like salt content can influence this. Increased salt content has been reported to hold back or prevent disproportionation, leading to a smaller median bubble radius. Second, and often more dramatically visible, is coalescence. As bubbles expand and the gas volume fraction in the dough increases, bubbles come into closer contact. They become polyhedral, separated by only thin layers of the liquid phase, often referred to as liquid films or lamellae. If the liquid film between two bubbles thins too much and the repulsive forces can no longer maintain separation, the film can rupture, causing the two bubbles to merge into one larger bubble. Coalescence can have a significant negative impact on the final bread quality. If bubbles coalesce excessively, especially in the interior of the dough, it leads to a broader and uneven distribution of gas cells in the baked crumb. If bubbles coalesce at the dough surface, gas can be lost to the atmosphere, resulting in a lower loaf volume. Extensive coalescence starting too early in proofing can also reduce final baked volume. These dynamic processes, diffusion-driven growth, disproportionation, and coalescence, highlight the importance of bubble stability. The dough needs to be able to form and then maintain these bubbles against forces that would cause them to shrink, merge, or collapse. The ability to retain fermentation gases and expand arises from the unique viscoelastic and strain-hardening properties of the gluten proteins in the dough. The gluten network, developed during mixing, provides a primary structural matrix that surrounds the bubbles. But as the bubbles grow and the dough expands, this gluten starch matrix can become discontinuous. This is where the thin liquid films lining the bubbles are thought to play a crucial secondary role in stabilization, preventing coalescence and disproportionation. The stability of these liquid films depends on surface active compounds present in the dough, such as proteins and lipids, which are adsorbed at the gas-liquid interface. Higher concentrations of these materials can enhance film stability. Furthermore, the strain-hardening characteristic of the dough, its ability to resist stretching more strongly as it is deformed, is a critical requirement for gas retention and bubble stability. Doughs with a higher strain-hardening value are better able to maintain bubble integrity and prevent disproportionation and coalescence. One of the things that can influence this is the quality of the flour. Flour quality significantly influences dough rheology, including its elasticity and strain hardening, and therefore affects bubble stability and behavior. For example, in this study, doughs made with a medium-strong flour maintained a more uniform bubble size distribution and have slower development of interconnected structures compared to those made with weak flours. Ingredients like lipids can also increase bubble stability. The water content affects bubble size distribution. As fermentation continues, the growing bubbles interact more and more. Visualizations using techniques like X-ray microtomography have shown the formation of clusters of partially coalesced bubbles. In some cases, this can lead to the development of a large interconnected structure, potentially forming a single tortuous closed cell within the proof dough. This network structure is reminiscent of the open cell structure found in baked bread crumb. After mixing and bulk fermentation, stages like punching, sheeting, and molding don't introduce new gas bubbles. However, they can cause the subdivision of existing bubbles, which can improve the number and size distribution before the final rise. Towards the end of proofing, gas volume increases, accounting for 70 to 75% of the total volume. At this stage, be aware that the risen dough structure can be quite fragile. Mishandling at this stage can disrupt the structure and cause gas loss. Now, the final act in our bubble life cycle is baking. Naturally, baking involves the dough being subject to increasing temperatures. While oven temperatures can get pretty high, the internal temperature of the dough rises progressively from around 30 degrees Celsius at the end of proofing up to approximately 70 to 95 degrees Celsius. This temperature increase is crucial for several reasons. First of all, dissolved gases like carbon dioxide become less soluble. Second, water and ethanol evaporate into the bubbles as temperature increases. These factors contribute to the expansion of the gas bubbles during oven rise. Crucially, the temperature range of 50 to 75 degrees Celsius coincides with the physicochemical changes of starch latinization and gluten cross-linking, which set the crumb structure. Temperature also affects the rheological properties of the dough, particularly strain hardening. Strain hardening tends to decrease at higher temperatures, and this decrease is more pronounced in doughs from cultivars showing poorer baking performance. Maintaining adequate strain hardening at elevated temperatures, especially up to around 50 to 60 degrees Celsius, is linked to good baking performance. If strain hardening falls below a critical value, within the temperature range encompassing the expansion phase and early baking stages, bubble walls become unstable. Baking is often the most critical stage for gas cell coalescence. If the bubbles start to interconnect at lower temperatures during proofing or the early stages of baking, while the dough is still viscous, the final bread baked volume will be reduced and larger bubble sizes will be produced. Conversely, if the bubble walls remain stable for longer during proofing and the baking expansion, preventing premature coalescence, then the final bread volume will be larger with a narrower or finer cell size distribution. During baking, crust formation on the outside of the loaf increases the pressure within the baking dough and can encourage coalescence, contributing to a loss of fine structure and coarsening. Some ingredients are thought to improve quality by delaying the setting of the matrix, which allows the bubbles to remain discrete and stable for a little longer during baking, thereby contributing to a finer crumb grain and increased loaf volume. So how do these complex dynamics affect the final bread we eat? The bubble behavior throughout the process is the primary determinant of the bread's final loaf volume and its crumb structure. A high loaf volume generally requires the incorporation of a sufficient number of initial bubbles during mixing, good gas retention throughout bulk fermentation, proofing, and early baking, and minimizing gas loss due to excessive surface coalescence. The rate of bubble growth driven by yeast activity and temperature also contributes to volume. The crumb texture and structure are directly shaped by the evolution of the bubble size distribution during bulk fermentation, proofing, and baking. A fine, uniform crumb is typically achieved by starting with a large number of small, evenly distributed bubbles from mixing and maintaining their stability throughout bulk fermentation and proofing, minimizing disproportionation and coalescence. This often correlates with using strong flour that develops a good elastic strain-hardening gluten network. Conversely, if disproportionation is significant, leading to a wide range of bubble sizes, or if coalescence is extensive, the resulting crumb will have a broader, less uniform cell distribution with many larger holes. Using flours with lower elasticity or weaker gluten can promote faster formation of interconnected structures and potentially larger, less uniform cells. So, to summarize, the entire journey of a bread bubble, from aeration during mixing to growth during bulk fermentation, proofing, and final setting during baking, is a complex interplay of diffusion, disproportionation, coalescence, and stabilization forces. The dough matrix, primarily the gluten network and liquid film stabilized by surface active compounds and reinforced by strain hardening, is crucial for retaining the gas. Understanding these dynamics is key to controlling bread quality. factors like flour type, water and salt content, lipid content, mixing conditions, fermentation parameters, and even how the dough is handled after mixing all influence the evolution and stability of the bubble structure. So how do you use this knowledge to get the best results for different types of bread? Well, if you're aiming for a fine uniform crumb, like in a classic sandwich loaf or many enriched breads, you'll want to focus on incorporating a large number of small, stable bubbles during mixing. This often means using flour with good protein quality and ensuring sufficient mixing energy. During proofing, maintaining bubble stability through a strong gluten network and stable liquid films is essential to minimize disproportionation and coalescence, preserving that fine structure. Careful handling after mixing is also important to avoid the collapsing the fragile structure. For breads where a more open, irregular crumb is desired, like some artisanal loaves, some degree of controlled disproportionation and coalescence might be acceptable or even encouraged. The choice of flour, hydration level, and potentially less intensive mixing or longer, slower bulk fermentation and proofing times could influence how the bubble structure evolves towards larger, more interconnected cells. Techniques like folding during bulk fermentation can help manage and strengthen the network without necessarily aiming for maximum bubble uniformity. For any bread, good gas retention during the critical final proofing and early baking stages is paramount for maximum volume. This relies heavily on the dough's rheological properties, particularly its strain hardening ability, to withstand the internal pressure as the bubbles rapidly expand. Ensuring optimal fermentation conditions, adequate yeast activity and temperature ensure sufficient carbon dioxide production to inflate the bubbles. Ultimately, the best practice depends entirely on the desired outcome. It's a balance between the initial bubble formation, the complex dynamics of growth, shrinkage, and merging, and the dough's ability to retain the gas until the structure sets in the oven. By understanding the science of bubbles, bakers gain powerful tools to manipulate the process and create the exact texture and volume they envision. So I hope this deep dive into bubble dynamics was insightful. If you learned something new today, please give this video a thumbs up, subscribe for more food science explorations, and let me know in the comments below what other aspects of baking you'd like to see me talk about next. And that's it for this video. Thanks for watching, and bye!